3 weeks and three interviews later, I had a job offer. I have my job because of Grant Kirkhope. I still owe Grant Kirkhope drinks.
Welcome to the Gamer Symphony Dreams podcast, where we invite you to join us for an interesting and meaningful conversation on video game orchestras and video game music. Hello, everyone. Welcome to the Gamer Symphony Dreams podcast. I'm your host, Michelle Ng, and I'm here today with Joel Guttman. He's the co-founder of the Magruder Gamer Symphony Orchestra and the president emeritus of the University of Maryland Gamer Symphony Orchestra. Welcome, Joel.
Hey, Michelle. Thanks for having me.
Yeah, it's great to have you. So today we're going to talk a little bit about your involvement with video game music and video game orchestras. So to start us off, can you tell us what is your background and how did you get involved with video game music?
Yeah, so I'm the eldest of three children in my family. All three of us are musically inclined. Neither of my parents are. My siblings and I call ourselves musical mudbloods. It just, we don't know where it came from, but we got it for some reason. I wound up interested in music relatively early on. I took a semester of violin in fourth grade and then had to drop it just because crazy, you know, busy with other things. But then I picked up trombone in seventh grade. But in the midst of all this, I was getting into video games. And just for one reason or another, I always loved the music. One thing I just have a very, very vivid memory of very frequently in my childhood that I had a Game Boy Color and I would very frequently just turn the music up and just hold it up to my ear and just like in the car, like I would have to turn it up just a bit so it wouldn't be bothering the other people in the car.
Yeah.
But I think that's sort of where it got to what started me holding it up to my ear so I could listen to it. But like I would go specifically to different levels in different games where I like the music, just listen to the music. And keep in mind, this was before YouTube. This was before video game music was going to be really easily accessible. So I sort of fell into it very early. And then I saw play a video game symphony when I was, I think, probably 13, 14. Saw video games live after that. And then as I'll get into, I'm sure soon enough, things with the Gamer Symphony Orchestra happened.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it sounds like one of your earliest exposure was just like listening to the soundtrack, but you know, from the actual game console or the Game Boy in color. And that's something I've heard a lot from other people. It's like they're playing the game, they notice the music, and it kind of sticks out in their mind. And when they find out more about like when video games live, for example, started to come on the scene, that's when they got really excited and like attended the concert.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's so cool. So one of the things that you did is when you were in high school, you co-founded the Magruder Gamer Symphony Orchestra. Can you tell us what's the story behind starting that?
Yeah. So, we've had this conversation a couple times in the past, but I don't know if you know all of it, come to think of it, because it's sort of a two-parter. And the first part is, a couple years before the founding of the Magruder GSO, I had been just looking up different video game symphonies that I knew of play and I knew of video games live. And I was just Googling around one day. I don't even know what brought it on, just to try and see if there were others. And I came across a thing called the UMGSO. And it was a rudimentary website. I remember that it was a blue color scheme. You had Mario on the front page. This must have been like really early on. The website does still exist, but it's not in that form anymore. And my mother is a Maryland alumni. I grew up in Maryland in Montgomery County. And I remember asking her as I was looking at it, I was just like, all right, so I see Gamer Symphony Orchestra, but there's nothing on this website that says what the UM stands for. So just like, Mom, do you know what UM is? And she just sort of looked at me and was like, could be University of Maryland. It's like, oh, that makes sense now that I look at it, because these all look like college kids, huh?
Wow.
So I didn't think much of that. That was probably my freshman year of high school or so. Fast forward to my junior year of high school. One day I walked downstairs in the morning and my mom has a newspaper clipping. She was like, hey, I saw a picture of Zelda in the paper today. it was Toon Link, but close enough, Mom, close enough. But it was a blurb about the Maryland GSO's Fall 2008 concert. And it was going to be that Saturday. And this was after I'd seen play in video games live. So I already knew that I liked this stuff. And I was like, yes, I definitely want to see this. So I got three other friends of mine to come to the concert. And we just had a blast. Fast forward 3 days to the next Monday at school. I walk into the band room before school to drop off my trombone, as I do every morning. And one of the friends who I was at the concert with flies me down and was like, hey, Elliot wants to talk to you. And they were both waiting in the instrument room. So I drop off my trombone and I was like, what's up? And he was like, I want to start a GSO. And I had a moment. I've only had a moment like this, I think, three or four times in my life, where just sort of, it's almost like an anime or film where things just sort of go dark around you. Time sort of stops and you're left to your thoughts and you think at a mile a minute, and a lot of thoughts go through your head really fast, but it's really only a second in real time. And the thoughts were pretty much as follows. That sounds awesome. I know this friend of mine. He dreams big. He's disorganized as all heck. He's had plans and like other schemes in the past, and just he's never been able to see them through. I know that I'm pretty organized and that I might be able to do this. I already know that I want to go to the University of Maryland. This could be not only fun, but potentially relevant on an application in a year's time.
Oh.
And resume normal time flow. So he says, I want to start a GSO. And less than a second afterwards, I respond with, you're crazy. Let me help you.
I always remember
and that is very apt thing because I still say he's crazy. Love the guy. He's crazy. I'm a bit crazy. But it's the type of thing of just like, you can't do this alone. Let's do this together. Mm-hmm. So we approached our band director, who is a really great guy. Just I love my high school band director. His name is Mark Eisenhower. He graduated from Magruder and became the band director some 5 years later and was there for about 30, 35 years, recently retired. Mm-hmm. But he's not a super like emotive guy, but he's just very, very genuine. And so we sort of brought this up to him, and his response was in his very usual nonchalant way of just like, sure, if you can get the people. And to this day, I'm pretty sure he didn't expect us to get the people. Mm-hmm. But when we got the people, he kept to his word. So our first meeting had 14. It was mostly close friends that the other co-founder, Elliot, and I had more or less shanghaied into this little scheme of ours. But we got it off the ground, and that was mostly due to just sort of us brute forcing our way. But after the first meeting, when we were like, all right, this is happening, we emailed the Maryland GSO just sort of saying, hey, you've inspired us. We're planning on doing this. We didn't expect much of a response back. We just thought that they'd maybe get a kick out of the fact that we were doing this. And we got an email back some 3-4 days later from, it was Diana Taylor. Mm-hmm. And she said, that's awesome. By the way, we've been looking to potentially start some associated outreach groups. Do you want to like actually work with us? And our minds were blown. We were like, holy cow, like these college kids want to work with us? Mm-hmm. All right, let's do this. So my father went with Elliot, or drove Elliot and I to Maryland's campus. We met with, it was Diana Taylor and Rob Garner, who was at that point in, I don't know if he was president yet. I think it would have been the first of his like 4 years as president, because that guy was president for a while. Mm-hmm. And we met at Lido's, the original Lido's, before it was torn down and rebuilt on Route 1. So, and we just sort of talked things through. And the ultimate result of that was that we got the Tetris AB arrangement. So not the Kotobiniki arrangement that's been used by Video Games Live. It was a earlier version that used the AB themes of Tetris. And that became the first piece that the Magruder GSO performed. I conducted that piece, and Elliot conducted a Halo piece that we had arranged by ear together.
Oh, wow.
And we were allowed to actually perform at the school's actual concert. So like when the parents came in to see the symphonic band, the concert band, and all this, that we performed in between two of the bands, and we were the first student group to ever be able to do that. In the coming years, one or two other groups would be allowed to do this because we basically trailblazed that.
Mm-hmm.
But those were usually one-off things, and certainly that after the people who headed up those other little groups graduated, that didn't continue. That up until at least this year, circumstances being what they are with concerts not happening, the Magruder GSO has been the only non-classroom ensemble to perform regularly now for what would be over 10 years at the school's actual instrumental music concerts.
Oh, wow. I didn't realize it's been 10 years.
Yeah, it's been 10, which is
oh wow,
really weird for me too.
So,
So that's the super long-winded version of it all.
Well, that's so interesting because it's like, I guess the first time that you had ever heard of the GSO, like, did you make the connection like, oh, I should do something? Because the first time that you saw the website, right? But at that time you didn't think, oh, I should try to start something.
No, not at that point, because I would have been a freshman or possibly in eighth grade at that point. So it wasn't something that crossed my mind, and I don't think it would have been something that would have been viable at that point anyways.
Okay.
I think the timing was very relevant, that I was a junior. I had a very firm grasp on, my time management, so to speak, that just like, I felt that even though I did have marching band and I was in the drama club, that I was comfortable enough that I thought I could do this and see it through.
Mm-hmm.
And I also knew that I had enough friends that I could probably rope into being part of it to make it viable. And I don't know if I would have really known enough people as a freshman at that point.
Okay, that makes sense. Did you find that starting the Magruder GSO help you with, you know, because you mentioned that that second where every time slows down, that you could put it on your college application?
Yeah, it did occur to me, and it was definitely not the primary reason that I did it, but it was something that certainly occurred to me.
Mm-hmm. Did you find that it helped you with like getting to Maryland?
It's really impossible to say because nobody really ever knows what the deciding factor was on their application. That I did have pretty good grades and test scores, so I possibly could have gotten in anyways, but I have to assume it didn't hurt me.
Okay, because I think that might be something like that might be good for if anyone wants to start a high school video game orchestra. That's something.
Yeah, that for sure. About. That just like a school always loves to see if you're already involved with the school somehow. That and especially in such a unique way and such a thoughtful and artistic way, because simply put, most high school students aren't going to be involved on a college campus just by virtue of there's not many opportunities for it. There's not a very conventional ways for that to happen. So this inroad, as it were, I have to imagine probably stuck out on my application.
Mm-hmm. That's really cool that you thought about that and that, you know, like one time all stopped. So in regards to starting the actual Magruder Gamer Symphony Orchestra, so if it's been 10 years, was that like 2010 that it was?
Well, it's been more than 10 years now that the concert that we saw that led to the genesis of everything was the Maryland GSO's fall 2008 concert, and the Magruder GSO's first concert was spring of 2009. So this would be 11 and a half-ish years at this point.
Okay, so you guys had your first concert in the spring of 2009. Like during the very first like one or two semesters, was it kind of difficult to kind of figure out what to do, or did you have it pretty under control?
Hey, we took just a very straightforward approach of, because keep in mind, we weren't doing a full concert program. We didn't get that amount, that kind of, time to work with at the school concerts. That we had one or two pieces, and it was basically keep it under 10 minutes was what we were able to work with. And to be fair, like,
Okay.
that's super generous. That, like, I don't mean to complain. The fact that we were given the time of day at all at the school's concerts was just a it was extremely, extremely generous of the band director to allow. So we were not going to complain, but it also meant that things were relatively simple. That it was just, everyone comes to rehearsals and knows, all right, it's this one or two pieces. We had rehearsals just once a week. We wanted to make sure it was a very minimal time commitment. One, because I was very busy. Like I said, I was already in marching band and in the drama club, and I knew many of my friends that I had gotten involved were also very busy as well. So one of the big pitches I had made to my friends when I was trying to get them involved was, this will be just one day a week. It's going to be like an hour and a half, 2 hour practice. It's not going to be super complex pieces, and we're just going to have fun. So we tried to make it as low pressure a situation as possible, which isn't a necessarily going to be viable or the goal of every GSO. But I think that it's definitely how a high school GSO has to operate, just because of the types of restrictions that you have there that aren't necessarily as prevalent at a college or community level.
Yeah, it sounds like because you guys only were able to get 10 minutes during like the other official ensembles of the school, you were a little bit constrained and not be able to have like a full program, but
Yeah,
it's
it
it
worked in our favor very much, because it also meant that we'd never had to worry about like finding a venue. We didn't have to do advertising because all the parents were already coming to see their kids anyways. So
Yeah.
just all this sort of like red tape and just legwork that most other ensembles will have to do was already done for us. So it was very convenient in that sense, because I don't think that we would have been able to manage and put on a full concert as high school students. And even if we had, it would probably be, like 20 to 30 people in the audience at someone's house or wherever we were able to make it, not in like the actual school's, auditorium with the hundreds of parents that are coming to see the concert anyway. So it meant just a better venue, way better crowd, because like the parents are always super, super supportive. And everyone loves it when it's the kids doing things themselves. So we got a lot of support, even from just like the parents who didn't have kids in the ensemble. So it really, I think, worked out for the best there.
Yeah, sounds like it did. So did your band director help out anyway when it came to things like conducting or like teaching, showing you
A
guys?
bit. That one thing that we had wanted to make sure in our pitch to him to allow this in the first place was that he would not have to be involved in a significant capacity. Fortunately, we already knew that he usually stayed after school each day, just, doing his normal work. But we didn't want to cause a significant burden on him, that it would generally just be like if we hit a particular snag, that like if there was a passage that we'd been working on and just really couldn't get, we might call him in for 5 minutes and be like, do you have a pointer here? And we would maybe do that 3 times a semester, not very often at
Okay.
all. But in those moments, it certainly showed why he was a band director, because in those times where we were like, all right, let's call in Mr. Eisenhower, he was usually able to like untangle whatever we couldn't figure out just in a matter of minutes. And it was always very, very good. But a big thing was also allowing the students to conduct. So we wanted to, that was as much for keeping it a learning experience for us as it was keeping the burden off of him. And
Okay.
past that, it would just be the week or two before the concert, he would come in and listen to a playthrough just to give us the general green light. And there was never any issue, but it was him doing his due diligence to make sure that we didn't go up there and embarrass him. but it was always just, you know, all right, everybody, let's do this. We've been practicing and we already knew we had it pretty good. And his office was, you know, attached to the room anyway. So he's probably been hearing us anyways. Mm-hmm. So it was always just, all right, yeah, you're good.
Well, that's good. Did you guys have, I guess, how many officers were involved at the high school?
At the start, it was myself and the other co-founder, Elliot. And like I mentioned, for the first concert, we each conducted a piece. Mm-hmm. And then for the second performance, we only had one piece. And when it came to deciding, all right, who's going to conduct, I knew that he wanted it, that it was something that was a big interest for him. Mm-hmm. So the agreement that we came to is, all right, you're the conductor, I'm the president. And mm-hmm. like I said earlier, we both knew that I was the more organized of the two of us anyways. So he was like, yeah, so you're going to take all that administrative and clerical work? Oh, man, he felt like he was getting one over on me. And I didn't feel like I was getting one over on him, but that way I did still want to have, you know, a leadership stake in it. Because we very much saw each other as co-founders. And even though I had the president title, the power dynamic was very much equal. So for the year and a half that we ran it, it was a two-officer thing. But that was also just because at this point, when we graduated, it was about 25 people. But there ultimately wasn't much to actually, you know, manage mm-hmm. other than just making sure that we had a piece, that rehearsals got into the morning announcements at school, and that rehearsals were run. There wasn't any real clerical work or budgets or like voting. And actually the way that we handled our successors was just by nomination, or rather appointment, that it was just, the group was small enough at that point, and we knew who was going to be becoming a senior, who had been most involved and who had the most capability. And it was never really an issue for us at that point to just sort of choose our successors, because it was such a small and simple group. I know that after we graduated, that they added an officer at large. I don't know how they might have changed it if they continued to just, you know, appoint their successors or actually create comprehensive elections, but we never, you know, drafted a constitution or anything. So we left it very open to mm-hmm. the management of the students at the time, and they've managed it.
All right. That sounds awesome. Yeah. So after you, after high school, you graduated and then you came to the University of Maryland, you joined the Gamer Symphony there. Can you tell us about your role and involvement with the University of Maryland Gamer Symphony Orchestra?
Yeah. Obviously, when I got to Maryland, so I wanted to go to Maryland. I think the first time I said I wanted to go to Maryland was when I watched the men win the NCAA championship in 2002. Keep in mind, like I said, my mother was an alumni anyways, and it's the state school. When I got to be a freshman in high school, I said, all right, I probably don't want to go to Maryland. This is probably just a passing fancy. But then as I started looking other places and started looking in Maryland, I was like, no, I actually do want to go to Maryland. And when I got there, having done the Magruder GSO, I obviously knew, all right, I'm going to get involved in the Maryland GSO. And the Maryland GSO had and has, I believe, open officer meetings. So while it's the officers that still, you know, run things and vote on things when necessary, anyone was allowed to come and listen and contribute to discussions. And I took advantage of that from day one. Fortunately, a good portion of the officers already knew me because I'd met them from being involved previously. And I just sort of dove in head first. I think it was probably the third or fourth meeting when one of them, after rehearsal, said to me, so Joel, you want to be president eventually, don't you? And I was like, yeah, I'm not going to hide that. I'm not going to be subtle. and I actually got a bit of a leg up early that the vice president, my freshman year, had to step down because they got a co-op in Connecticut. So very positive circumstances that they had to leave under. It was just like, all right, great. you got this really awesome opportunity, but they have to leave. So the way it worked was one of the two officers at large was then appointed as vice president. And then there was a officer at large slot open. And the way it worked is that if a office became open in the middle of the year, that the president would simply appoint to fill it. And since I had been at all of the meetings since the beginning of the year, they asked if I wanted the role. And I said, yes, I do. Mm-hmm. So I wound up being an officer as a freshman, which under normal circumstances isn't possible. So after that, I ran again for officer at large and won as an incumbent, which was relatively easy. Just spoiler alert, the GSO's elections, at least during my time, were not very difficult or, you know, political. It was just, all right, do you have the experience? Okay, that some roles were contested. Sometimes people would run unopposed, but at least the ones that I saw, for the most part, were not really, you know, contentious. Mm-hmm. And even those who didn't get elected would usually still stay involved peripherally anyways. I think it's definitely an advantage of when you have a musical organization like this, when it's not really ideological, mm-hmm. or, you know, complex in its operations. It's just, we know we want to put on a concert. We know we want to get it done. So we're just going to try to get it done. Mm-hmm. That nobody ever really ran on a platform because there's no platform to run. It's just, all right, we're going to do stuff. And maybe people would have some new ideas over the years, but, you know, nothing terribly robust or complex. Mm-hmm. And then the next year I basically went through what was the logical ascension of roles at being officer at large again my sophomore year, then ran and won for vice president my junior, and then ran unopposed for president my senior year.
Mm-hmm. And then that's when you became the president of the University of Maryland Gamer Symphony Orchestra.
Yep.
Can you talk a little bit about, like, because I know you want to share something about when you're president. Maybe we can wait until that question. So I just want to switch over to asking you about, what do you think are kind of the main differences between running like a high school GSO and a university club orchestra? What are some of the similarities?
So like I mentioned earlier, the differences are really in scale and in scope. Mm-hmm. That scale of just sheer numbers, that unless you go to a particularly large high school or a particularly small college, the number of members you're working with most likely is going to be much smaller at a high school than a college. And then scope in terms of the size of a production that you're going to put on, that, as I mentioned, we had just a smaller concert, whereas obviously Maryland and most community level GSOs are going to have, you know, full concerts where they're in charge for getting the venue, doing the advertising, and all those other logistical things that we simply didn't have to worry about. During my time in Maryland, I did help one other high school start a GSO. Unfortunately, it just didn't last as long, but for the time that they had it, it was run very similarly to Magruder's, where it was just, you know, run through the music department, or at least, you know, mm-hmm. parallel, so to speak. And I think that's, at least when it comes to high school specifically, how it needs to be done, just because high schoolers aren't as knowledgeable, but also don't have the same types of time and resources that you have when you're either a community or a college, in terms of the types of things that you can do. No one's going to rent space to high schoolers, and then it would require parents, and then that just gets so much more complex from there. So it's always easier and smaller scale by virtue of being a high school organization. But the similarities are basically everything else, that everyone wants to have a good time. They want to play this music. In our case, we did some of our arrangements, but also borrowed. So that really can vary by group. But in the end, everyone is participating for the same reasons, and the goals ultimately are the same.
Mm-hmm. All right. Yeah, that's some, I think that's definitely true with what no matter what kind of ensemble you are, you have similar goals of putting on a concert, having a good time.
Yeah.
Can we talk about some of the, when you were the president of the University of Maryland Gamer Symphony Orchestra, what would you say were some of your proudest accomplishments?
Yeah, so one of my proudest accomplishments, well, two of my proudest accomplishments, I'd say, actually happened before I was president. One was a purely logistical and administrative thing, and that was my, I think it was sophomore year when we did a overhaul of the group's constitution that I specifically lobbied for and got in ranked choice voting, which I was very proud of, because up until then it had been simple plurality voting in the elections. And I saw that there were some elections that would have, you know, like for officers at large, there'd be two roles, but then there'd be four, five, six people running. And I was like, that's not practical ultimately. And ranked choice voting, I'm not sure if you're familiar, but it's a relatively simple system where you just, you know, write in the number one through however many candidates. And the way it works is you do a count and see, all right, did any candidate get 50% or more of the rank one votes? If not, you drop whoever got the least rank one votes, and then whoever had a two in those become ones. Recount. Did somebody get 50%? If not, repeat until somebody does. So it's a bit long-winded to say out loud, but in terms of actual implementation, it's very easy. But that way, people can actually vote, and when you have a wider field, it makes sure that the person elected is actually one that is ultimately the most desired by the voters. But the big one for me was in my junior year when we got Austin Wintory to come to Maryland for a seminar and to watch us perform. It was the closing theme from Journey. I'm blanking on the name. I Was Born for This. That's it. Now, the story behind this one. So one of the things I was also involved with at Maryland was the National Honorary Band Service Fraternity, Kappa Kappa Psi. As I would find out, the GSO and Kappa Kappa Psi prior to my time did not get along well. Just the personalities in each group at the time were not friends. It wasn't particularly like, it wasn't animosity or anything, but the groups just didn't really want to do much with each other. But when I got involved, I essentially bridged the gap, and eventually many others in the GSO would become brothers in Kappa Kappa Psi and vice versa. So while I was the first to be involved with both, by the time I graduated as a senior, I think that there were probably some 7-8 brothers in the GSO, including two of the conductors, and several of the other officers, because the band service fraternity is very much a leadership type thing. So it made sense that there was going to be crossover in those leadership bodies. But one of the goals of Kappa Kappa Psi is to enrich music on campuses in its entirety. The primary goal is to support the university's bands. So we would do fundraisers, we'd help set up game days, stuff like that. But it's also one of the group's missions just to enrich music and music education on the campus as a whole. And one thing that had been discussed for some time was bringing some musician, some established person to campus for a seminar. Now, since we had worked with Austin, Okay, slight reordering of events. I Was Born for This was performed my sophomore year, and that's why I had Austin's contact information. It was the next year that I used that contact information to reach out to him. And he said that he'd be interested, that he'd be more than interested to come and do a talk. And he was like, I don't need any speaker fee. I will come if you just cover my flight, cover my hotel. I just don't want to lose money on this. And that's all I'll ask. I'm more than happy to give my time. So I was able to, I talked this over with the GSO, and obviously they were like, we'd freaking love to have Grammy nominated Austin Wintory come to talk and see our concert. That'd be mind-blowingly amazing. And meanwhile, I'm then able to go to Kappa Kappa Psi and say, all right, we've been looking to have someone come do a seminar. I have here a Grammy-nominated composer who is willing to come and talk at no speaker fee, so just at cost. I've looked up flights, I've looked up hotels, and it was well under $1,000. So, like, we had a budget to work with, and this was well under it. And the pushback I knew I would face was going to be, all right, well, you obviously have a conflict of interest, Joel. We all know that you're involved with the GSO, and we know that this is to get Austin Wintory there for the GSO. And I said, yes, I am absolutely playing a double agenda here, but I'm making it so both groups win, because not only do we get this and accomplish our goal of, you know, helping enrich music on the campus, but since I'm an officer in the GSO, I can assure you that in exchange, the fraternity's logo and name will also be on every flyer that goes out around campus. Mm-hmm. We're going to have a spot in the program, and we're going to have a shout out on stage. So our name will get out there. We will get publicity from this. And you all know that the GSO's concerts get more attendance than any other concert on this campus.
Yeah.
So, I felt like I was getting away with something. But ultimately, it was just like, it was good business. It was a win-win for everybody. And that's why I'm so proud of it, because I was able to go from these two groups before my time not really getting along at all, mm-hmm. to actively collaborating and pulling off just a heist of a win, where we got Austin freaking Wintory to come for what was just an incredible, incredible seminar. I think it's still on YouTube. The audio quality isn't great, but it was a great talk. He came to the concert. He had a great time. And it really was a win for everyone that the fraternity got its name out there. I obviously delivered on all the promises. I made sure those flyers had our logo and name, got it taken care of in the program, made sure the president knew what to say during the announcements. And it was just really, really great for everyone. As for my senior year, when I was president myself, comparatively, there wasn't anything super stellar that year, admittedly. We had had the Smithsonian performance the year before, but I was not president at that point. We didn't have a Smithsonian performance my senior year. Mm-hmm. I was proud that we put on two very, very strong concerts and that things ran smoothly. But I suppose there wasn't anything quite as flashy my senior year that I attribute my emeritus status a lot to my spearheading of the Gamer Symphony Orchestra sort of, you know, growth initiative of mm-hmm. getting more groups founded around the country. So not just that one high school group, but the Ithaca, the RIT GSO, the UCLA Game Music Ensemble were all groups that approached Maryland like I had approached Maryland beforehand. And just I had sort of made it my mission when I got to Maryland to help other groups as I had been helped to make it, so they didn't have to reinvent the wheel. Mm-hmm. So a lot of my accomplishments were really just over that span of the 4 years, not really focused on presidential things in particular.
Mm-hmm. Well, it sounds like you did a really great job in kind of bringing everyone together and creating a win-win situation. I think that's so awesome that you did that. Because I know sometimes it's kind of tricky to, you know, if two groups haven't been getting along well, it might be tricky to kind of bring them together.
Yeah, and that was definitely a overtime thing. And fortunately, just the people who hadn't gotten along had since graduated. Mm-hmm. And there was sort of, when I was a freshman and sophomore in particular, I could sense the residual, I don't want to say resentment, but just trepidation. Mm-hmm. At the interactions of just, there were one or two of the older brothers in the fraternity who were a bit like, oh, you're involved with the GSO. And there were a couple older people in the GSO that were like, oh, you're getting involved with Kappa Kappa Psi. That nobody told me don't interact with the other. They're awful people. You shouldn't do it. But people were like, we haven't had stellar relations with them in the past. But I could also detect that from what I got from each side, I could tell that it wasn't an unsalvageable situation. That just sort of pushed me more of just like, I think there's something here. I can, from the stories I heard, I understood why the groups didn't really get along. And I think it really just boiled to the personalities involved at the time and a couple isolated incidents where each group had a turn sort of being in the wrong on small things, like just sort of, you know, making sure the room was cleaned up afterwards or that there was a communication error between the two. I didn't really think there was anything that was like, there was no backstabbing involved. There was nobody trying to sabotage the other group. And that's why I felt all the more motivated to like smooth this over time and see the groups actually come together. And I was really happy that when I graduated, that there was not only that connection, but also getting to be like that amount of overlap of members.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think that's really awesome that you pulled that off. And I, you mentioned doing like a lot of outreach. So you got a cool opportunity to work, to tour with Video Games Live and work with Tommy Tallarico. And you actually promoted the idea of starting a GSO like to Video Game Live audiences. Can you share just how did you get this kind of opportunity? And can you tell us what was involved in doing this work?
Yeah, the how was I asked, and this was once again, I had Tommy Tallarico's contact information because my freshman year was the year that Video Games Live had contacted Maryland because they had a performance at the Strathmore with the National Philharmonic, and that's where the collaboration, which ultimately resulted in us giving them Korobeniki, what is now known on their end as the Tetris Opera. That it simply was not going to be feasible to get, you know, 120 piece group on stage, get the National Phil off stage, get us off stage, get National Phil back on stage. Wasn't going to happen. But since Korobeniki is a Russian folk song, that meant that it's public domain. So they didn't have to worry about any rights. So we were able to give that to them with the just, you know, pretty standard agreement for accrediting and whatnot, and that they were able to have it in their Smithsonian performance. And the piece was, to say that it had a good reception is an understatement. It was the highlight of the concert and has since become a staple of the Video Games Live rotation. It's on the Level 3 album, which I made sure I was in touch with Tommy because this was, it was that year that I had worked with them. So I made sure that if you have a physical copy of the Video Games Live Level 3 CD or look through the credits, it not only says arranged by Chris Apple, which he was already going to have, but I got him to add the line of arrangement provided by the Gamer Symphony Orchestra at the University of Maryland. So I made sure that the Maryland GSO's name is on the back of every Level 3 CD.
Oh, I didn't know that.
Yeah.
That's pretty cool.
Yeah. And as for how I got involved with them, so we worked with them my freshman year. So we had his contact info on file. And one of the things I did as officer at large one of the years was sent out the VIP invites, which included Tommy. Obviously, we never expected him to come because he lives in California. He's not going to make it, but it's, you know, not a formality, but a courtesy to invite someone like him after we'd had that collaboration, even though we knew the odds were effectively zero. But this also meant that now I have Tommy Tallarico's email address. So I sort of abused that access, but obviously it was with good cause because when I called him, first I emailed him, and basically the pitch I had was, I want to help more people start Gamer Symphony Orchestras. what can I do to be able to come around with you all and do this as a promotion? It makes you look good because you're supporting students in the arts. We already have this interaction. I can help in whatever way, and just I'll make sure that I can make it worth your while as well. Mm-hmm. And Tommy, who's just super genuine guy, but also he's very straightforward. He's mm-hmm. not going to give you the runaround. He was like, I'd love to have you, but just I can't justify the cost of bringing around someone who, you know, like isn't a professional and going to be, you know, contributing very, very, very significantly to the production. Mm-hmm. If you're at a show, I'd be more than happy to give you the time of day on stage, but just he was like, there's airfare and then hotels and all that other stuff. And just like, that adds up very, very quickly. And I already run with a relatively small traveling crew that it's usually only 6-7 people that are on the Video Games Live production crew. Everyone else is the local house crew. Mm-hmm. So I was like, totally understand. But I see that you have Wolf Trap in Virginia on your schedule. I can make that. Mm-hmm. Oh, you have a Nashville show. That's where my father grew up. I can make a family trip out of that. Oh, mm-hmm. you have a show in Connecticut. That's a 4 or 5 hour drive. I can do that. I'll make a road trip out of it. And so that summer, I did 6 Video Games Live shows in a month and a half, I think. Mm-hmm. And just, I made it so that I was there and it didn't cost him anything, but he let me go out on stage. He would let me talk to people afterwards. He actually had me on the autograph line a couple of times. Like, I don't know why people want my autograph, but apparently people did. But I also then was able to work backstage. For all intents and purposes, the way I have it on my resume is a production assistant. That I assisted the stage manager. I helped do the setup beforehand. I did some inventory for, you know, the merchandise. I escorted the costume contest people on and off stage. I hosted the costume contest once or twice. I'd be the runner who got the score for the winning Guitar Hero contest and spoke with the person during intermission so that they knew what to do in Act 2 when they had to come up on stage. So I got that backstage experience and got to see the inner workings, which is just a ton of fun for me as this, you know, at this point, rising senior in college, just to be able to do all this. So it was very much a win-win, and I was very fortunate to have that opportunity. And Tommy and I still talk every now and again, not as often, obviously, since I'm now working and he's as busy as ever, now also running in television. But yeah, he's a great guy.
Wow, that's so cool that you had like basically created opportunity for yourself. That like you had like the desire and you just took a chance, took a risk and just asked him if he would be open to it.
Yeah, I'm the type to just be sort of a crazy schemer, and it's sort of just how I was raised, and my parents would always sort of encourage me to think big and not be afraid to ask for things that I want. And it's certainly paid off.
Yeah, absolutely. Were there any people that came up to you like after the concert to ask you about starting a video game orchestra?
Yeah. One of the ones, I don't remember if it was the UCLA group or if it was another group in California, but one of the California groups came out of the show that we had in Irvine, because that was a special one that had a lot of stuff from Blizzard, because that's where Blizzard's headquarters is. Mm-hmm. There were a couple others, I can't remember which offhand, but I know that there was a good like dozen people that had approached me like with real genuine interest, and I believe it was 3 or 4 or 5 ended up getting started from all that, which I told myself, if I can get one group per show, then that's like incredible. And mm-hmm. I didn't expect necessarily to. So like, if I didn't really get a bite, so to speak, it was like, whatever, I'm still here. I'm still getting experience and just having a blast. So it was just like, all right, anything I can really get here is gravy.
Mm-hmm. Oh, that's awesome. So there was another opportunity that you had as a student, which was to work at E3. And there you met video game composers like Marty O'Donnell, Austin Wintory, and Neil Curry, just to name a few. How did you get the opportunity, and like, what did you do as part of your experience there?
That was one of the video games live shows. So to be clear, I did not work E3 itself.
Okay.
As part of E3 2013, 14, or 15, I have a screenshot of the email because since E3 is a trade show, it's not a convention. You can't just, you know, buy a ticket. You have to be in the industry. And Tommy said, all right, you can submit an E3 application and you can put video games live on it. That he gave me a video games live email to work with and everything. And so I did get to go to E3 with a video games live credential. And basically I spent the day going around just walking the show floor. And it was on, I think it was the Friday or Saturday night of E3 that we had the concert. And it was basically the biggest video games live concert that had been done to date. I have let me grab my phone because I know I have the set list from that night because I took a lot of pictures and I've kept them. But I want to say that there was, I think it was 7 or 8 guest composers and conductors that night.
Wow.
That it was just, because usually it's just Tommy and maybe one or two guests, but this was like a star-studded one. All right, yeah, nope, that's not it. Should have looked this up earlier, now that I think about it. All right, I'm close, because that's the pictures of me when we went to video game, not the video games live, the Blizzard headquarters. Where is it? Oh, this is going to bother me now. Off the top of my head, it was Marty O'Donnell and Mike Salvatori, the composers from Halo. There's Emer Noon and Craig Stewart Garfinkel, who had also worked at Blizzard. Emer would later be the conductress of Legend of Zelda Symphony of the Goddesses, and to this day is a recurring guest conductor whenever their main one, Emmanuel Frettiani, isn't available. Russell Brower, since this E3 was in LA, then meant that Irvine was only like an hour and a half away, so there was a lot of Blizzard there. Gary Scheiman, who had done Bioshock, I believe it was. Austin Wintory. Peter Hollins was there, I believe, who is not a composer, but a very, very successful YouTube cover artist, for lack of a better term. Also really great guy. And there was a couple others as well. I'm probably blanking on some of them. And so I got to sort of meet all of them backstage. My big role for that one backstage as, you know, assistant stage manager, production assistant, or whatever you want to call me, was I was the runner and just sort of the handler for these, you know, like almost a dozen VIPs. So I'd be going to the green room and be like, all right, Mr. Salvatori, your piece is in two pieces. So we want you to come on to the wings, Mr. O'Donnell, if you would. I helped swap out a couple things on stage, but a lot of it was just sort of coordinating, making sure everyone knew when they had to be in the wings or when their entrances and exits were. And I pride myself on not getting starstruck. That I had, obviously, like, internally, I was like, oh my gosh, I'm working with all these really, really successful composers. This is awesome. And the only person that I didn't lose it, but the closest that I really came to just fanboying was not one of the composers. It was Alexey Pajitnov, the creator of Tetris.
Oh my God.
Because he was there. I have a picture with him.
Oh, wow.
And I was backstage standing next to Alexey Pajitnov while Video Games Live performed the GSO's arrangement, Korobeniki, the Tetris opera.
Wow.
And I told him, I said, this arrangement was done by a group that I'm involved with. So indirectly, because you chose this folk song as the piece for Tetris is why I am standing next to you right now.
Oh my God. You're
Because
so
it, because it, if the GSO hadn't had that collaboration with Video Games Live, I wouldn't have had the standing to, or the contact info in the first place to reach out to Tommy. Like maybe I could have, but it certainly wouldn't have been as easy that he wouldn't have necessarily known who I was already. So it was very special to sort of have that of like, this is not the only reason why I'm here. But if you trace through the cause and effect tree here in the space-time continuum, that's sort of the catalyst for it all. And it was a very special experience.
Wow, that's amazing. Like, you never imagine you'll be standing next to like the creator of Tetris at a Video Games Live show.
And I
Wow.
don't think I would have really geeked out for like anyone else, save like if it was Miyamoto, Iwata, or like Uematsu. Like those are the only other three people I really think that I would truly geek out over. And it, but yeah, so just because of all that cause and effect, meeting him was particularly special.
Wow, that sounds super special. It sounds like you had a lot of really cool experiences while you're a student, and I wanted to kind of talk about like can you explain like what you do in your job now and how your past experiences, all the experiences that you had as a student with the GSO and with Video Games Live, how did it help you get to where you are?
Oh, it's very direct because once again, the GSO is one way or another responsible for over half the things that I'm involved with nowadays, indirectly or directly. Well, one of them, this is sort of an unnecessary one, but still a fun one. By getting involved with Kappa Kappa Psi, there is also the National Honorary Band Service sorority, Tau Beta Sigma. One of the people who was a sister at the time was a member of the GSO. And the way that it worked for the two organizations, that they worked very much in tandem. And that when you're going through the membership initiation process, you are told to pick both a big brother and a big sister, one from each organization. And so naturally, I asked, her name is Anna Costello, who was a French horn player. And in the GSO at the time, she was, I think, the only sister that was in the GSO. And so I asked her to be my big sister because we had already interacted and gotten along very well. But that was sort of like the, all right, why I really, really wanted to pick her. And we continued to get to know each other. And she suggested that I go to my first anime convention, which was Katsucon. And that's where I met the people from Funimation, which is, if you're familiar with anime, one of the premier anime licensors and distributors in North America. And at KatsuCon, I met the folks there, and it ultimately led to me having a marketing internship at Funimation. So there was that of just, all right,
Cool.
because I met the person and, got more involved with the people I knew from the GSO that she suggested I go to the convention, which is where I met the people, which is where I got the internship. But the other one and what I do now, I am a QA lead now at a company called Boss Fight Entertainment. It's based in Dallas, Texas, well, the Dallas-Fort Worth area. We also have a second office in Austin, and the company is a bit over 100 people now, but I was employee number 30, 6 years ago this month, actually.
Oh, wow.
Started as community manager, then started to do QA, and now I am full-time QA lead and also partially associate producer. I do sort of a dual-wielding role there. But the way that I got this job was because of Grant Kirkhope, the composer of Banjo-Kazooie and Donkey Kong Country and Perfect Dark and GoldenEye, among others. He's also done, it was Mario versus Rayman Raving, or Mario Rabbids Kingdom Battle. That's the name of it. It was the Mario Rayman crossover from a couple years back. And that happened because Grant had been talking at the Smithsonian concert before the GSO went on, because they had a whole thing for the art of video games. So they had invited him to do a little talk before we had our concert. And he also previously had worked for a company called Big Huge Games, which was based in Timonium, Maryland. And he would come to the GSO's concerts pretty frequently. Actually, wait a minute. No. Sorry. Scratch that. I think Austin was talking at the Smithsonian. The way that I had met Grant was because he had just come to the concerts because he was in Maryland. But anyways, so I had gotten to know him just very, very tangentially. We only had a couple conversations, but once again, I had his contact information. And at a point, I had always known I wanted to work in the gaming industry, and I'd been sending out applications with relatively little success. And what I started to do was I started to reach out to all the people that I had met just via Video Games Live and other places, and just sort of catching up with them, but also in the meantime, letting them know that I'm looking for work in the industry. And the natural response is, oh, I'll keep my ear to the ground for you. And that's really all I was trying to do. That's all I would never dream of asking for anything more than that, that I wanted to reach out to these people, one, just to get to know them better, because networking is important, but also because they just seem like genuinely good people as a whole, that when I network, I try to make friends, not connections. And it was trying to get to know them better as friends, but also knowing that I could probably get them to keep their ear to the ground for me. And I had a conversation with Grant, and about 2 days later, he pinged me on Facebook saying, hey, Joel, a buddy of mine just posted saying that his company's looking for a community manager. Sounds like it might be up your alley. And I was like, sure, yeah, I'd love to get in touch with this guy. And 3 weeks and three interviews later, I had a job offer. So I have my job because of Grant Kirkhope. And like whenever I post basically every year on the anniversary that I started working for the company. And if you go on my timeline on Facebook, you'll see it because I made the post only last week. And I said, I still owe Grant Kirkhope drinks because I haven't because of our own separate busy schedules, I still have not seen the man in person since he got me my job. And it's been 6 years now. Like we interact on social media every so often. And like, I know he still remembers me. But we haven't actually had a chance to meet face to face. We tried to meet up at MAGFest a couple of years back, but he was naturally busy and so was I, and just we never got the time to sit down. But I've sworn that whenever it may be, might take another couple years, but I owe Grant Kirkhope drinks with interest.
Yeah. It sounds like the moral of the story is try to work with celebrities and then get their contact information.
Yeah, it doesn't sound good when you say it like that, but the way I think of it is just like, get to know people. And like I said, don't try to make connections, try to make friends. That like and that is very much reality of the gaming industry, as I've come to find. And I think it's really a thing of business as a whole, but it's not a thing of even nepotism or favoritism. It's a matter of trust, that just when you have a bunch of people applying for a job, whether it be for an accounting firm or a video game developer, you're going to get a lot of resumes, and you can't judge people based on resumes. But if someone at the company or a friend of someone at the company refers someone and says, I can vouch for not only their resume, but their personality and their drive and all the intangibles that a company looks for, that's going to carry weight. And that's not being deceitful. That's not being, unfair. That's just them having an extra piece of trust, be it secondhand trust in this case, that the person, the applicant, is good for the company. And just there's no company on earth that isn't going to take that into consideration. And it is certainly a powerful thing. And it doesn't matter if you're in video games or any other industry, that recommendations are really good to have. So that's why, like, that's not why I try to make friends, but it's certainly nice to have friends in those places when things like that come around. But also on my end, if I had just been really awful and, you know, like gotten fired from Boss Fight early on because I was slacking or just like not good for the job, that one, Grant certainly would probably not talk to me or ever recommend me again, but like it would look bad on him and I would never want that for him. So just it's very much a give and take, because it also makes him look good, because now obviously he has this sort of extra connection to the company that I work at now. But it also means that it's just rising tides lift all ships, you know?
Yeah,
I'm a bit long-winded, so we'll boil it down to that. It's just like, he now knows more people. I now know more people, and he knows far more people than I do. But I certainly hope that someday I'll be able to return the favor. I don't know how or where or when, but I owe the guy. I really do.
Yeah. So what would you say are your some words of wisdom for students wanting to go in the games or entertainment industry?
Put yourself out there. All the stuff that I've accomplished and done is really a result of me asking for it, going out of my way looking for it, not just applying. That I sought out Grant and all these other people to talk to them, to get to know them, to try and hopefully get some people to be on the lookout for me, but also just I was going to be equally on the lookout for them, because also I knew all these other composers now, of just like, if I had gotten wind from one of these, from Russell Brower or something, that totally hypothetical. And like, if I had seen him post and be like, we're looking for contractors, obviously I know or assume that Grant knows Russell, but if there's ever an opportunity where I know that two people aren't connected and I see an opportunity, I always go out of my way to introduce people. So look for introductions, but also make introductions, because once again, lifts all ships, that you're helping other people and then they'll hopefully think of you when another opportunity arises. So just make friends, not connections. Do things to create opportunities for yourself. So just ask for things. Don't be afraid to ask for things, especially when most of the time asking really costs nothing. That if I had called Tommy Tallarico and he had said, no, just I'm not comfortable having someone I don't really, really know be backstage in my productions, I would have totally respected that. And that doesn't mean that Tommy Tallarico would have hated me, and that wouldn't mean that people will generally not think less of you for asking for an opportunity, assuming you ask in a polite manner at an appropriate time and in a thoughtful way. That don't just go up to someone and be like, hey, can you give me a job? That's not going to work. But if you are mindful and are like, hey, I think I can do this thing and I see how I can give you value as well, that I made very sure that when I talked to Tommy, it was just like, this can make you look good, because, you know, for any interviews, how are you supporting arts or students and whatnot, that like, you can throw me out there. Like I make for a real good feel good story. But also I can help out backstage. I'm not going to be just lazing around waiting for my 2 minutes on stage to talk about GSOs. I will be an extra set of hands. And I've been backstage in enough things just from high school theater to know that, dang, an extra set of hands can be invaluable. And I know that I was able to do a lot for him, and just like the shows would have been fine without me, but I know for a fact that I made the lives of everyone else backstage easier because I took a couple of things off their plates so they could spend more time doing all the other things they have to do. And that's a very real thing, very real value. So just make sure that it's, even if it's not a perfect equivalent exchange, because I know I probably got more than I gave there, but it wasn't for lack of trying. And it also wasn't necessarily them bending over backwards. That for me, the value was simply by virtue of being there and backstage and being able to have that on my resume. Tommy didn't have to do extra work for that, but that's still a really big thing. So hopefully in that way that it's just called good business when each side feels like they got the better end of the bargain, and just try to create those situations, those deals of make it so you're offering to help and to give as much as you want to get. It might not always be equal. Don't look for it to be, you know, like necessarily even a financial transaction. That Tommy paid me a little bit, but it wasn't, you know, like a wage, nor was I looking for a wage. And obviously when you're a professional, don't do your work for free, but this was, you know, internship style stuff, which is why I was comfortable with it. And I was fortunately in a position where I was able to do that. And I recognize not everyone always has that situation, but if you do, do look to see where you're able to, you know, take advantage of that, of any good fortune you have, and hopefully make good fortune, not just for yourself, but for those that you work with.
It sounds like you create a lot of like win-win situations for everybody. And it sounds like also that you really enjoy connecting people. And
yeah, that's very much always my goal. Just like going back to the thing with the GSO and Kappa Kappa Psi for Austin Wintory, that was me looking to just create win-wins, make sure that everyone feels like they're really getting something out of it, introduce people. Like, nothing's more fun than seeing two of your friends become friends. Like, yeah, it's a great feeling. And it certainly applies in business as well. And what goes around comes around, for sure.
Yeah, absolutely. Do you have any words of wisdom for students wanting to start a Gamer Symphony Orchestra, either at the high school or college level?
Obviously, a lot of things are not normal right now because of the state of public health. So I can't give too many particular recommendations on how to handle this because I haven't tried to organize a group in this situation. But in general, whether it be trying to do one social distancing wise, or when things eventually return back to normal and you can have in-person ensembles and performances, of just do it. Cliche as it is, that just figure out what it is you need to do. So if you're in high school, ask your band director, try and get some friends together. If you're at a college, colleges make it painfully easy to start a student organization. That is literally why they are there, that there's going to be an SGA advisor or someone whose job it is to help students start groups. And then just start with a small group of friends, start to advertise. And even if you only have a dozen or 20 people at your first performance, or even if your first performance is just a chamber group of five or six, everything starts somewhere. I know that the GSO's, the Maryland GSO's first rehearsal, I think had 12 or something.
It's probably a little less than that.
Yeah, that just like these groups start small and are designed to scale and grow. And that's fine. Don't think that you need to have a 120 piece orchestra and a full chorus for your first performance. You don't need that. You just need to start it. Don't get overwhelmed by all the things that all these other groups have done because they've had more time to do it. And all these groups have started small and grown from there. So work with what you have, talk to the people that you need to talk to in whether it be, authority positions or just like documentation for starting your student group, or be it a venue if you're a community group for wherever you're going to hold your rehearsals, and just start having those rehearsals. Obviously, with social distancing and everything, I don't really think that there's necessarily an easy way to start it. I know the Washington Metropolitan GSO has been doing some very interesting things with remote work. I don't know the full details because I'm not directly involved with them, but they seem to be really pioneering the approach as it is necessary at the current moment of this interview. But when things return to normal, hopefully being sooner rather than later, get people together. Goodness knows that when we're able to, people are going to want to be together again. So hopefully there might even be a bit of a boom.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, those are really good words of wisdom for anyone who wants to start a video game orchestra. So I have to ask you this question that I ask all my guests. What is your favorite video game soundtrack or song, and as well as your favorite game?
Yeah, I saw that question. I was like, oh, that's just not fair.
Yeah.
Can't do that. Like, I could probably give you a top five or top 10. I don't know. That's difficult. Even having the time to think about it, I wasn't able to land on really just one. So I'm going to cheat and go with three. In no particular order, I would say the ending theme from Kingdom Hearts 2, which is called Fantasia alla Marcia, which is just gorgeous, sweeping orchestral piece, which was done by Yoko Shimomura. Gosh, ugh. Now I'm thinking like, all right, the question going through my head right now is which Final Fantasy piece is it? Which Final Fantasy piece? And I'm really not sure. I'll probably go with. I don't want to say One Winged Angel because that's too obvious. I'll say I know that Tommy Tallarico's favorite video game piece of all time is Libre Fatale, the opening to Final Fantasy VIII, and I also think it is a great one. I don't know if I'd call it my favorite, but there's a little trivia for you, and it's definitely up there for me. I really like that piece. Oh, the Maria Andreyko opera. That's it.
Oh, that's a good one.
The Maria Andreyko opera. That would be my favorite one from Final Fantasy, particularly the third movement. Just gorgeous. And then got to be something from Pokemon. Probably really just the main theme as was done for the champion in Red in Pokemon Gold and Silver. Just the classic dun 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 da 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 da. Yeah.
This is a
So those for
classic.
me. And then for games, for Pokemon, it would be once again, Gold and Silver. I think that the jump that Pokemon made from Gen 1 to 2 was just so astronomical, and it was just great. Legend of Zelda, it's got to be either Breath of the Wild or Twilight Princess for me. Twilight
Oh,
Princess is the
okay.
one that I know isn't as popular, but what I will say about Twilight Princess is it has my favorite final boss sequence of all time, of any video game. Period. It just statute limitations is well past for Twilight Princess, so spoiler alert, just you have what is a very satisfying first you face Zelda and then you face Beast Ganon and you defeat Beast Ganon and it looks like, all right, Midna's made this heroic sacrifice. Hyrule Castle is exploding, and what do you mean Ganondorf is rearing up on his horse, crushing Midna's mask? Just like that moment, and then you have not just one but two more fights with him, ending in just this super climactic sword fight that is basically just like that's the sword fight that it's always been meant to be, and to even if it wasn't one-to-one motion using the Wiimote, that it felt really good, and just like the final blow that you have, definitely my favorite boss sequence of all time. Though I would say that Breath of the Wild is a better overall game because it's just so massive. So those two are somewhere tied for also really favorite game. And then Maybe Animal Crossing, but that's possibly recency bias. I don't know. There's a lot of great games out there, and I've already cheated a lot on this answer, so there you go.
All right, thank you so much, Joel. So, where can people find you or like reach you?
Yeah, so on LinkedIn, just look up Joel Guttman, currently based in the Dallas area, just Joel Guttman. I don't use Twitter as much as I used to, but for what it's worth, it's at Joel_Guttman. I'm not super, super big on social media, but one thing that I, well, sort of two things I've been involved with recently is with a group called Digital Era Entertainment. It's basically a collective of friends who just stream and do nerdy content together, just under a shared umbrella. It's really a passion project. And the way that you can find that online is for Twitter at Digital Era Tweets and on Twitch at Digital Era Twitch. And I do three things with them. Every Thursday, I do streaming with another one of my friends named his name's RJ. We're currently doing Pokemon Sword and Shield Crown Tundra. But we've also done visual novels where we've done voiceover for all the characters, and that's always a lot of
Oh,
fun.
that's cool.
And that's Thursday nights from 8 to 10 Eastern. On Fridays from 4 to 5 Eastern is the D-Kai podcast, which is an anime podcast. As I mentioned, I had an internship at Funimation, and on the side, I also do, or at least did do, a lot of convention work when conventions were viable, and hopefully more once they are again. So, and that's myself, the founder of Digital Era Entertainment, who I met working conventions, and two voice actors, and it's just the four of us talking anime for an hour every week, with just being big anime nerds, but also having industry experience in our respective realms. So having that as sort of the added layer, and then I've also been directing and producing radio dramas about once a month of nerdy films. It all started when I got my hands on the script for the Pokemon Live stage musical from 2000. And that sort of spun off into us doing a production a month or so. And we've done Pokemon movies. We did Monty Python, The Holy Grail, Clue, Phoenix Wright. Our most recent one was actually this past weekend, when we did The Princess Bride, and it's all just, it's done as a radio drama. So it's done with full narration. We don't have, the background sound for copyright reasons, but it's done as live performances. And it's the closest thing to theater we really have right now, and we always have a lot of fun with it. Our next big production for that will be on Saturday, November. I need to double check the calendar to make sure I get the date right. It's the 20th. 24th, I think. No, it's the 21st. Saturday, November 21st, we will be doing Agatha Christie's Murder on the Orient Express. So that's always a lot of fun. And then we have the recordings available on Digital Era Entertainment's YouTube channel. So yeah, it's always something nerdy and fun. And you can find me in those different places.
Yeah, that sounds like a lot of fun, and hopefully, listeners go check out Joel's work, and connect with him. All right, Joel. So thank you so much for taking the time to chat with me today. It's been a lot of fun, and I think you provided a lot of really important tidbits of wisdom and information that people can take with them and they can use. So thank you once
Yeah.
again, Joel Guttman, for chatting with me today.
Oh, once again, thank you for having me, and thank you for listening to me ramble.
Bye.
Talk to you later.
You've been listening to the Gamer Symphony Dreams podcast. I hope you enjoyed this episode. Let us know what topics you'd like to hear more about. Until next time, keep living you and your Gamer Symphony dreams.